Well, good morning. We're continuing our series of messages called I Love Sundays. And today our message is this, that Sundays changed the world. And what I'm saying is that it is Sundays that have made the world a better place. And I'll go into what I mean by that a little bit more throughout my message. But people who believe in making Sunday a Sabbath day unto the Lord, I love this description. They are called Sunday people. You are Sunday people. And there's something significant about that. And I want to make a statement this morning, and I want it to be a statement that is a fairly bold statement. And then what I'm going to do is throughout the course of my message, I want to prove that statement to you this morning. So here it is. I believe that the Church of Jesus Christ, God's Sunday people, have done more lasting good in this world than any other group in history. And I'm going to do everything I can to prove that to you this morning. In marketing, what you do is you ask a question. And you ask a question that really points out what would happen if this truth that you're trying to portray didn't take place. And so what I want to do is ask you this question: how would the world be different today without Sunday people being in the world for the last 2,000 years? Some people in our culture, in our world today, are great at looking forward into the future in order to help make the world a better place. And they have the desire to make a positive impact on the world. Throughout history, there have been many, many people that have made huge impacts in our world. There's a name that you might be familiar with. His name is Charlemagne. He was the first Holy Roman Emperor in 800 AD. Charlemagne was himself illiterate for most of his life. And yet Charlemagne believe that every child in the Roman Empire, which was the vast majority of the known world, should have the right and the ability to learn to read and write. So he created what was known as the public education system. Here in our own country, in the early years in the U.S., a failed farmer, a lawyer, a governor of Virginia, eventually one of our founding fathers, Patrick Henry, said, "Give me liberty or give me death," in leading an uprising against the nation of England. How about men like Abraham Lincoln, who led our nation through its darkest hour, the Civil War, where 623 people lost their lives in that battle, in the line of duty, all in order to abolish slavery. Then there's a man named Johannes Gensfleich. He believed that people should have access to books and learning. So in 1455, he became the first man to mass produce a book using movable metal type. You know, those who possess the ability to imagine a better future and then create it, that's a gift. It's a gift that not all of us have. The history of our wonderful nation and even our world is laden with such people. But I believe that in history, that history literally will bear out the fact that there is no greater example of this than a seemingly ordinary man who worked with his hands as a carpenter. He learned a trade, that trade from his father. He was born in very humble beginnings, never rising out of poverty. He had no wealth of any kind, not even a home, not a family, and yet this man gave something to the world that no one else could give. If you haven't guessed it yet, his name is Jesus Christ, and the gift that he has given our world is his church. This morning, I want to start out and talk to you about the rise of that church. the rise of the church. In the closing days of Jesus' life and his ministry here on earth, he met with his followers. We read about it in Matthew chapter 16. I want you to follow along as I read. I'll read several verses here just to give you a little bit of the context. When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say the Son of Man is?" Jesus is asking them, "Who do people say that I am?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah." Both those men were already dead at this point. "And still others say Jeremiah, also dead, or one of the prophets." Verse 15, "But what about you?" he asked. "Who do you say I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." Jesus replied, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my" what?
Church.
"And the gates of Hades will not overcome it." Friends, Jesus must have either been speaking the truth, and he knew he was telling the truth, or he was delusional, because Jesus, at that moment of speaking those words, had no real following. He had no money. In order to... Man, let's face it. Today's the 17th, right? Friday was the 15th. So taxes they've made due on the 18th, okay? Right? All right? Jesus on tax day could not pay his taxes. He sent Peter out to go fishing. He said, "The first fish that you catch, I want you to open his mouth and you're going to find enough taxes for you and I." Jesus didn't have anything. We understand that. We know that. He didn't have any wealth. He didn't have any possessions. He didn't possess worldly position. He didn't have any political clout. In fact, a 5,000-year-old religion known as Judaism and the Roman government were against him, yet this little group of people that were gathered around him would make a difference on the earth greater than any other group before them or after them. Those words that Jesus spoke, "I will build my church," brought into being the most powerful entity on the earth. It's not a company. Today, when we think of powerful things, we think of companies. It's not a company, it's not a firm, it's not a corporation. Some have tried to define it as an institution. I had a friend once that said, "Marriage is a great institution. I just don't want to spend the rest of my life in an institution." People have tried to describe the church as an institution. It's not merely a group. It's not a consortium. It's not a conglomerate. It's not an agency. It's not an association or a society. It is a body of people who are bound together with a particular purpose. And a quick perusal of the Gospels, you will find 13 times that Jesus used the words, "Follow me." Do you know that those words are, because of the frequency that they are recorded in the Gospels, they are the most recorded statement that Jesus ever made? "Follow me." Meyer's commentary says that what Jesus really meant was, "Be my pupil. Follow me. Be my pupil. Learn from me." In other words, copy what I'm doing, learn what I'm doing, and then keep doing it. Well, what did Jesus do? Jesus healed the sick. He set the oppressed free. He raised the dead. He gave sight to the blind. He proclaimed the good news of the kingdom of God everywhere he went. And on the night of his arrest and his subsequent execution, Jesus gave his followers a mission. We call it the Great Commission. It's found in Matthew 28, 19. It says, "Therefore, go and make disciples." These are Jesus' words, "of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit." Jesus had told them just a little while earlier, "I will build my church. Just be my pupil. Learn from me. Do what you've seen me do. And then I'm going to show you how to literally change the world." We go from the rise of the church to the spread of the church. 40 days after his resurrection, on the day of his ascension, Jesus told his followers in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, he said, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem." Well, they'd been in Jerusalem a lot. In fact, they were in Jerusalem at that time. "And in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." So for 3 years, his followers had observed what Jesus was doing. He even sent them on short little practice runs. Did you notice that? In the Gospels, Jesus sent the disciples on little practice runs. He sent them out two at a time. And he told them what he wanted them to do. And wherever they went, what did they do? They healed the sick. They raised the dead. They gave sight to the blind. They preached the kingdom of God and his son Jesus Christ, who died and rose on the third day. They experienced a time after Jesus' ascension into heaven, a period of favor there in the city of Jerusalem with all society as a whole. In Acts chapter 2, the first part of verse 47, we read it. It says, "Praising God and enjoying enjoying favor of all the people." In those early days, following the day of Pentecost, the church enjoyed favor in the culture, the society that they were a part of. Now that sounds to me like a very enjoyable type of culture to live in, but why were they experiencing that? Now I'll tell you why. Because the people in Jerusalem loved them because they were going about and doing what Jesus did. People enjoyed that. They liked it, but history tells us that it didn't last very long. Because in AD 64, the Emperor Nero is believed to have set fire to the city of Rome in order to rebuild that city better than it originally had been. And in order to divert a growing attention upon himself, Nero devised a plan to cast blame. We read about it in history. A man named Tacitus, a Roman historian, preserved a record of what happened, and he's quoted from a work called The Annals. It says, "And so to get rid of this rumor," the rumor that Nero had torched the city, "Nero set up as the culprits and punished the utmost refinement of cruelty, a class hated for their abominations, who are commonly called Christians." An intense persecution by Rome of the Christians broke out that very same year. Tacitus continues in his work, The Annals, and he says, "Besides being put to death, they were made to serve as objects of amusement." We've all heard of the Colosseum, right? We've heard of gladiators. We've heard of the lions and the fact that Christians were put into those circumstances and they were torn apart. They were clothed in the hides of wild beasts and torn by to death by dogs. Others were crucified. Others were set on fire to serve to illuminate the night when daylight failed. The result is that Christians all over the Roman Empire were forced to flee their homes, their communities, places where they were known as followers of the way. They went to Greece. They went to Turkey. This week as I was preparing, I thought Mike and Nikki followed in the exact same footsteps. They went to Spain and Italy and India and Africa and Asia. Why? All to avoid the persecution of Nero. You would think that Christianity would decrease, wouldn't you? Because of that persecution. But instead of decreasing, Christianity actually grew faster. It grew faster because people felt drawn to Christianity. These people were doing the things that Jesus had shown them to do, and they continued to do it over and over again. And even though they were persecuted, they continued to follow what Jesus had taught them. And what happened? People were drawn to Christianity, and as a result, Christianity began to continue to grow. Thirdly, the influence of the church. Let's look at Acts chapter 2 and verse 47, the second part of that verse. It says, the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. The church was growing rapidly. Now, this is pre-Nero, pre-persecution. This is before AD 64. But it says that the church was growing. In fact, their numbers were growing so greatly, So much, so rapidly that it began to cause a problem. Now, I don't know about you, but I would love to have that kind of an issue. That the church is growing so fast that it causes problems. That would be fantastic. But literally, there were thousands, and I am not underestimating this. The scripture says in one day, 3,000 men plus women and children came to Christ. So thousands in a very short period of time are coming to Christ. We know that this is continuing, including a very significant group that were widows. And you say, well, what's the big deal about widows? Well, in the Jewish culture, widows really had no way of providing for themselves. They did not work. They did not have jobs. Their husbands had jobs, and when their husbands died, often they were left with nothing. In Acts chapter 1 and verse 6, we read this. In those days, when the number of disciples was increasing, the Hellenistic Jews among them complained against the Hebraic Jews because their widows were being overlooked in the daily distribution of food. The apostles realize that there's a problem. These widows are not getting food. There's a problem here. We're distributing food, but some of them are not getting them. They've got a problem. So the apostles appointed spirit-filled men to make sure that these people could get fed. And in Acts chapter 6 and verse 7, we read, so the word of God spread, the number of disciples in Jerusalem increased rapidly. This very first problem that we see in the church, that the church encountered, literally was the testing of Jesus' teaching that as members of his church, we must love our neighbors and our fellow believers. In AD 260, the entire Roman Empire was hit with a plague. It killed between one-third and one-half of the population. A bishop named Dionysius wrote this. At the first onset of the disease, the pagans pushed their sufferers away and fled from their dearest, meaning their family, throwing them into the roads before they were dead, and treat unburied corpses as dirt, hoping thereby to avert that spread and contagion of the fatal disease. But listen to this. The followers of Jesus, the people that were Sunday people, they nursed the sick and dying, and even spared nothing in preparing the dead for proper burial. There was a difference in those people. In AD 362, the Emperor Julian complained that the Romans needed to imitate the Christians because of their gracious treatment of the dead, whether they knew them or not. In fact, he said this, the impious Galileans support not only their poor, but also ours as well. And Julian did what anyone else would do in government. They start a program. And the program is to accomplish what the Christians are already doing. And as you can imagine, because it was a government program, it failed drastically. According to Dr. D. James Kennedy in his book, What If Jesus Had Never Been Born? It was Sunday people that invented the modern hospital, the university. They gave literacy and education to the masses. They created free enterprise, representative government, and civil liberties. Sunday people were those who abolished slavery in England and the United States. They elevated the status of women. They invented the very concepts of charity and benevolence. I've been thinking about this week, and the reality that for some, the idea of inviting someone else to church is a very difficult thing. But friends, I want you to understand that Sunday people have changed the world. Sundays have changed the world. And when we invite someone to church to be a part of the body of Christ, Jesus said, I will build my church. When we invite someone to come and be a part of the body of Christ, we are inviting them to a body that has literally been a part of changing the world over the last 2,000 years in a way that I don't think we think about very often. They say today that there are 7,000 languages in the world today. The Bible's been translated into 531 languages, complete Bible translation, front to back. 2,883 languages have portions of the Bible in that language. Do you know why the Bible has not been been put in all of those languages? All of those 7,000? Because they don't even have a written language. I want you to think about that. How many of you know that reading important? Zach, is reading important to you in your job and the kids that you have there at the school? All right. Travis, how about at your school? Reading's pretty important. I think about that with my kids as they grew up. If they can't read, they can't communicate. If they can't read, they can't communicate. They can't get a job somewhere. They're not going to be able to take care of themselves. It's so fundamental. Do you realize that it is Sunday people that have taken and literally written the language, many of the languages that we have today that are in existence in written form are because of Christians. Because they wanted to translate the Word of God. I talked about Charlemagne earlier, the founder of the Holy Roman Empire. He started the Christian school. Why? Or he started the public school system, rather. Why? Because he believed that kids not only had the right to learn to read, but he wanted them to read the Bible. That is unbelievable. Patrick Henry, his famous words, "Give me liberty or give me death," were spoken in a church service. Lincoln, our 14th president, was a devout follower of Jesus Christ, brought about the emancipation of slaves in this nation. I mentioned a guy named Johannes Genzfleck. That was his real name, but he preferred to be called by the name Gutenberg. February 23rd, 1455, printed the first book using metal type on a machine that became known as the Gutenberg Press. It was the first mass-produced book in all of Europe. The first one in the world printed with metal type face. You know what that book was called? The Gutenberg Bible. 180 copies. There were only 30,000 books in all of Europe. And 180 of them were printed, were the Bible. We have 49 that have survived today. A single volume today of Gutenberg's Bible would be worth $35 million. That book was in Latin, every verse of the Bible. In 1522, a man named Martin Luther translated that book into German, which quickly became translated into English as well. Why? So the common man could read God's word. 21 million Bibles were sold about 2 years ago in the U.S. Sold. That's sold, not given away, sold. The Gideons last year, 59.5 million Bibles given away around the world for a total of 6 billion they've given away. Friends, people have paid with their life. John Huss, the morning star of the Reformation, was burned at the stake for possessing a Bible that wasn't in Latin. And do you know what they used to start the fire? The pages of that Bible. Friends, Sunday people have changed the world. Why? Because they believe in the Jesus of Sunday. They believe that he's the Messiah. Pastor Bill Hybels of Willow Creek Church in Chicago, he said the church is the hope of the world. Friends, the church, the people of the Lord's Day, the Sunday people, I want you to get this. We are over 2 billion strong, and yet we feel like we are the minority voice. Friends, if the church will wake up, it's often called the sleeping giant. We are Sunday people, and Sunday is the Lord's Day. Today, my objective is to demonstrate to you that Sundays have changed the world, but also to be very specific to encourage you that this becomes personal, that Sundays can change you, that Sundays can change me. Maybe you're here today, you might be out in the hub or here in the sanctuary, and you think to yourself, you know, I come to church, maybe even regularly, but I really haven't thought about it that way, Pastor, that Sunday people have changed the world. Well, the way it happens is one person at a time. And so today, if you realize that God is speaking to your heart and there are some changes that he has maybe bringing your awareness to, you know what? Jesus not only set it up to change the world, but he wants to change us individually, one at a time. So I'm going to invite you all across this place and out in the hub. I want you to stand together with me, would you? Father, as we prepare to close this service today, I pray, Lord, that your Holy Spirit will move in our hearts this morning. And I pray two things. I pray that each man and woman and child that is gathered here today would understand that together as Sunday people, we can change the world. I don't know if they heard me, Lord, because I said that together as Sunday people, in the name of Jesus, with the power of the Holy Spirit, we can change the world. It has been done, and it will continue to be done. And it doesn't matter the amount of persecution that may come. If we keep doing what Jesus showed us to do, there's going to be people continuing to come to know Jesus more and more. And that brings us to our change. Jesus wants to change you today. And maybe as I have shared this morning, maybe the Holy Spirit is speaking to your heart, saying, you know what, my son, my daughter, I want to bring some change in your life. I'm so glad, as I prayed earlier this morning, that there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. This morning, the Holy Spirit draws us with cords of love. This morning, I want you to think about that. What is Jesus here today to change in your life? What does he want to change in you? I'm going to have the worship team lead us for just a moment, and I want you to think about that. Lord, what do you want to change in my life? If Sundays can change the world, then I know they can change me. What do you want to change in me? Let him speak to you today as they sing.
If you you've accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior today as a result of this message, I would encourage you to contact us here at Silver Creek Church by simply emailing me at kevin@silvercreekchurch.org. I'd love to be able to pray with you, and I'd also love to send you what's called Walk by Faith. It's a simple week-long devotional that we've prepared in order to help you as you begin this journey of faith in Jesus Christ. I pray God's blessing upon you today. Thank you.